Hello, good morning, afternoon, and good evening, everybody. My name is Fezile Mathandela from Conservation South Africa, and I'm the Health and Conservation Coordinator. I welcome you all today. Today's session, it is my pleasure to welcome you all to a session which will focus on strengthening water governance for resilient communities. We are recording today's session, and your participation in this is your agreement to the recording. Our session today, though, is going to be super interactive. And with that being said, we would like for you to participate in a few questions which can help us understand your understanding of advocacy. We'd also just firstly like to thank Conservation International, Conservation South Africa, Helvetus, as well as IRC for co-hosting the session. And now for this part of the session, we would like you please to refer to your practical chat where you'll find the agenda, where you found the agenda for the session. And we'd like you please to answer the following question. Firstly, we'd just like to understand where are we all coming from this afternoon or this morning or this evening. So the first question, please could you answer, where are you joining us from? Where in the world? Which country, which room, or perhaps which province or city? If you could please type in your answer on the practical chat. See the United States has just shown their presence. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. We still have the chat in Zoom open for just helping you once we start playing games. But if you could kindly answer in the pathable chat, we would love to see that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks, Colleen. So yes, I do see some answers coming through on the pathable chat. I see that there's a variety of people coming from different parts of the world. And this is going to be exciting because it means in today's session, we're going to actually hear different views and actually spread the word of advocacy across the globe. So I see that we can continue to the next question. Please, can you describe for us what word would you best use to describe advocacy? So just one word that you would use to describe advocacy. And if you could please continue to type your answers on the practical chat and not in this Zoom chat. Thank you. Okay, so we've got some responses on how people would best describe advocacy. And we see that there's different views that are coming through. And perhaps with this session, we will be tackling some of those words or perhaps clarifying them or just having you all have a better understanding of the term itself. I see that the answers are still coming through. Some very interesting answers coming through, by the way. All right. And then let's now look at the third question. So, how would you rate your experience when it comes to advocacy? You have none, little, or a lot of experience. So, if you could just describe to us briefly, what is your, how would you rate your level of experience with advocacy? And then again, this answer also goes right through to the pathable chat. Thank you. Again, we're seeing a variety of levels of experience with this term coming through in the pathable chats. Very interesting answers there. And again, this level of experience is going to also benefit all of us here today as we will be getting different views around what advocacy is and who is using it and how in their different areas. Yeah, I see there's some responses that are coming through from the Zoom chat that have also been put in our Pathable chat, but similar answers from what we were getting. So I see that there's a lot of you have answered to the last question. Thank you. Next slide, please. All right, just some house rules as we go through with the session today. We would really like it if you could please, please use the Pathable chat and not the Zoom chat. This is for questions and for comments as well. We do have people on board who are constantly checking the Pathable chat. So if you could please post your comments and questions there. And also please bear with us as technology can sometimes be not on our side. Thank you very much. And now I've come to a point where I would like to introduce you to one of my colleagues who will be joining us in today's session. I'd like to introduce you all to Ellen Walter from IRC. Ellen Walter is an international advocacy expert, and Ellen is also well experienced in both capacity building and the implementation of advocacy initiatives. Ellen today is just going to brief us with a presentation and to set the stage before we begin our very interactive games. And so with that being said, Ellen, the floor is yours.
Great, thank you so much, Fez. Welcome everyone, very excited to have you here with us today for this wonderful interactive session. I'm going to just set the stage. There were some really great responses that I saw and in the chat about maybe how you might define advocacy or words that come to mind. And so for the purposes of this session, we are defining advocacy as the practical use of knowledge for the purposes of social change directed to government policies, laws, and procedures, as well as their implementation. We know that advocacy is and should be a deliberate process. It aims to inform and influence decision makers. It seeks to changes that are evidence-based. One that's not listed here is that advocacy is really an important additional way to amplify programmatic work that's being done to help achieve the sustainable development goals. So there's a variety of different types of advocacy approaches. There are some that are listed here around lobbying, so direct interaction with policymakers or parliament, asking them for specific changes to policies or budget lines. There's things like campaigns, so that could be local campaigns via radio, or national campaigns around things maybe like hand washing or other wash or health related activities. Meetings with government officials, so one-on-one interaction with those that hold power, those that are able to make the decisions. Translation of research is another approach. Translation of research may look like policy briefs or memos to government officials. It can also be the translation of research for the general population so that they can advocate for themselves to those decision makers in their communities. Education and influencing events. So things like celebration of World Water Day or Global Handwashing Day. Other events that bring and bridge the gap between those that are looking for services and those that have the power to make change around those services. Consensus building, and then creating champions. There's a lot of different and exciting approaches that we're going to hear during our interactive games. So the only other thing I wanted to add here is around the lobby and advocacy continuum. So lobbying and advocacy there was a watershed program that many people on the call were involved in. And that is this continuum works from kind of the dissent side. So things like boycotts or strikes, and even nonviolent actions around things that are campaigning in the street, things like that, all the way to what we talked about, what I talked about in the last slide, around meetings with government officials, more lobbying, writing of papers, and that's more on the dialogue side. There's some key messages that you're going to hear, and we're going to come back to these at the end. But it's really important to note that local voices can be very effective for influencing change in policies, practices, and planning for water governance. And it's going to be really exciting to come back to these messages at the end to see if you've heard that throughout the games. Climate justice on the ground is an important means for successful water governance at the local level, all the way up to the national level. And lastly, the management of wash and freshwater ecosystems must be connected in plans for holistic management of water resources. So advocacy around these issues plays an important role. So now we get to the fun part of our session. We're going to do introductions to the games. We have from Conservation South Africa, we have Fez, who you met at the beginning of the session. We're going to have from Helvetas, Mumita, and then from IRC, Ariane. And each of these colleagues are going to give us a little snapshot of what you're going to see in their game. So Fez, you have 30 seconds. I'll click on your slide to introduce yourself and your game. Over to you, Fez.
Hi, actually Fez asked me to step
yes,
in.
Yes, sorry, Colleen.
That's okay, yes, I'm Colleen Sorto. I'm with Conservation International, and CSA is our South Africa affiliate. When Bez and I join your breakout rooms, she's going to walk you through an example that looks at that holistic management between conservation and WASH and tell you the different pieces of the puzzle for making advocacy success. You'll help us put that together through three different steps. Thanks, Ellen.
Great. Thanks, Colleen. All right. Over to Mamita. Go ahead.
Alan, I'm getting in.
Okay. I'm getting all the names wrong here. Yeah, Ashish, yeah. Please go ahead.
Thanks, Alan. So yeah, you can see that word Mother's Parliament. So welcome all from Bangladesh, right? The diverse landscape, the land of hope, despite there are challenges. So you know that Bangladesh is the topper of the climate vulnerable nations, but in reverse, it is the model for disaster management and the champion in climate change adaptation, right? So how comes? Who are behind this success? The people itself, who are championing the community themselves. So today we will hear the stories, how the women champions in the Southwest Coast, almost on the Bay of Bengal, have been a good example for advocating water governance. So please join us, enjoy it with the heroes. Thank you, Aline.
Great, thanks so much, Ashish. And I think I got this one right. Ariane, I believe that you're doing
yes.
this one. Okay,
you
great.
You got it right. Yes. Thank you very
Excellent.
Much.
Go ahead, Ariane.
Very much looking forward to you to take you on a journey. You're going to be choosing and joining us on a journey that we've had with Watershed, which is a program of ISC, ACFO, CIMAVI, Wetlands International, and a whole host of civil society organizations. And we'll be having four choices for you. Find your evidence, be part of it, follow the money, or secure your water. And depending on that, you'll be going to Bangladesh, Kenya, or India. Over to you again, Ellen. Looking forward to
it. Great. Thank you so much, Ariane. So here are a couple of questions that we want you to be thinking about as you go through the game. How does the case study integrate community voices and water resource protection into the water governance? What specific changes are you hearing or are you seeing in policies, practices, or planning for water governance through the inclusion of local voices? Do you see any multi-stakeholder partnerships, so local communities with civil society and government institutions? If so, which ones do you see? What role did they play in the process? So what happens next? So you will be automatically put into breakout rooms. And then the teams themselves, so each of the, you'll go through all three games, but you'll say you will stay, sorry, in the same room the entire time. So the participants will stay in the room, but the teams that are leading each game will rotate through the rooms. Specific game instructions and all of the associated links will be provided once you're in your small groups via the Zoom chat. Please use the pathable chat for any questions that are not related to the game itself, so more content-related questions. Colleen, I think your hand is up, so please go ahead.
I did. I just wanted to stick my hand in here and say that because of numbers, even though we had a full session, in order to maximize the fun of the games, we're actually going to stay in the main room and then go through the order. And our presenters know the order that our games are going to go. So sorry about that, Ellen. We had a full session of over 300 people, but now it looks like we have just the right amount. Sorry for the interruption.
Thanks, Colleen. That's really helpful to know. So we're all going to stay in this main room, but you'll have the opportunity to play all three games. So that's very exciting. And so at this point, let me just, whoops. I'm going to stop sharing my screen and turn over to Chris to Fez and Colleen for the first game. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen and over to Fez and Colleen for game number one.
Momita, Helvetas is up first.
Helvetas is up first. Okay, great. Sorry, Momita, go ahead.
Thank you, everyone, for joining our session. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to you all. Before I start, I'm going to share the stories and evidences from Bangladesh, but please keep yourself muted when you're not speaking. If you have any questions or any comments, you can use the pathable chat, but during the game, the Mentimeter link and the Jamboard link will be shared through the Zoom chat. Let me start. I understand most of you know about Bangladesh. Bangladesh is one of the most climate vulnerable countries in South Asia. And every year, the country faces the natural disasters like cyclone, flood, storm surge, earthquake, drought, salinity, nutrition, and so many. And climate impacts making these disasters is worsening by increasing its severity and frequency. In addition, we have improper resource management, our socioeconomic setup, our existing social inequality, and lack of awareness adding these miseries more. Bangladesh has several risky zones, but today I want to highlight one of the most exposed regions is Southwest Coastal Belt. In my slide, you can see the Southwest Coastal Belt map. This is Khulna Division. Climatic upshots actually affecting this region since the birth of Bangladesh. And climate affects this population by increasing the sea level rise, saline nutrition, increased and severity of flooding, prolonged water periods, and waterlogging. And the consequences on the communities are having the salinized water in ground, soil, and all the possible water sources. And prolonged water period and water logging destroys all the possible water facilities and the sanitation facilities. And the salinized waters adversely affect the people's health and sanitation, and they do not have the access to potable water as well. While discussing these scenarios, some questions are burning in my mind, I'm sure yours too, that why these communities are still vulnerable considering the climate change effects. Are they not aware of their water rights? If so, then what are they doing to ensure or secure their water rights? Or they are moving forward to influence the water governance? Are these issues being considered under the lens of climate change? Or they include the women perspective as well? To some extent, the answer is yes. There are several pieces of evidences on the ground that have been working against the climate change in the country. But today, I want to take you to one of the pieces of evidence, which is called Mother's Parliament. To raise awareness of the communities and create a space for their concerns and issues to be discussed and resolved, this Mother's Parliament is involved. As we all know that climate change and disaster affect our communities disproportionately, and socially ascribed roles and underlying inequalities, uneven access to power and knowledge work behind this. And technology and smart innovation sometimes forget to consider the aspect of social equity and gender justice. This platform was built to create a voice for these vulnerable and disadvantaged women. This is a locally led initiative to empower women to influence their water decisions to build a resilient communities. This locally led initiative was first developed and initiated by the Development Organization of the Rural Poor. Later on, it was supported and adopted by Pani Jibon Project of Helvetas Bangladesh. Let me share one of the quote of speaker of Mother's Parliament, Shathi Rani. She pointed out very clearly that how this climate change and disaster affect men, women disproportionately. Hence, women who are the most affected, always excluded in all kinds of decision-making and planning, which is facilitated by the male. And the beauty of this platform is this platform and the concept was evolved by realizing this ground reality rather than imposing something from the central. And I totally agree with Shathi that if we don't speak for ourselves, who will? And this platform beautifully portrayed and established the concept that most affected should have the most participation. Let me share the structure of this Mother's Parliament. This Mother's Parliament work at the sub-district level, but at the lowest tier of this region, the ward level, they have 130 health village groups. And the member of this health village group went through a democratic election and 9 elected members form one Mother Parliament. They have one speaker, 2 deputy speakers and members. And this platform work and identify problems and concerns through this health village group who have direct communication with this community. I will stop here and I will take you to one Jamboard and let's have some fun for our own. You can find the link in the chat box. Please quickly go to the link. And task X, you have, there are 3 columns, principle, function, and success. The task is to drag down each match toward according to you under each column. If you have any problem in accessing, please let me know. I can see the most of you are in, my words are moving. Yes, the locally led initiative under the principle, the budget and tracking under the function. Yes, thank you for your thought. Yeah, as I was saying that this Mother Parliament actually identify problem and prioritize them with the help of this health village group. And they not only identify problem, but also have access in allocation budget by advocating with local government. And they also monitor how this allocated budget actually used on the ground. And they successfully have a smooth journey by engaging all the local communities. And as I can see that Changemaker Award under the success. Yes, absolutely right that this platform secured the global recognition by ensuring the Changemaker Award of Global Water Partnership. And this platform showed and proved how an organized platform into a right place can bring the local best practices on the table and ensure maximum local participation. local, yes, I can see you already put your thought that local level planning, resource mobilization under the function. Exactly, you are right, you are. And recognition from the stakeholder, yes. Changemaker Award may be a material success, but immaterial success or significant impact on the community is definitely the recognition from the stakeholder. And yes, enhance access. This successfully create a space for this woman who cannot speak before. Thank you everyone for your active participation. I can see that all the words are into place. So let me take you one of the video where speaker of Mother Parliament speak, and let's check what we are thinking behind a computer matches with the ground reality.
জলবায়ু পরিবর্তনের কারণে লবণাক্ততার বৃদ্ধির ফলে আমাদের নিরাপদ পানির উৎসগুলো নষ্ট হয়ে যায়, যার কারণে সমাজে পিছিয়ে পড়া জনগোষ্ঠী তারা পানি স্যানিটেশনের মান উন্নয়ন যাদের কথা মূলত ভাবে না কেউ, তাদের নিয়ে আমরা পানি স্যানিটেশনের মান উন্নত করার লক্ষ্যে মা সংসদ কাজ করছে। মা সংসদের মাধ্যমে 4টি পিএসএফ সংস্কার, 87টি পানির ট্যাঙ্ক এবং স্কুলে টয়লেট সংস্কার, ইউনিয়ন পরিষদের মাধ্যমে 200টি স্বাস্থ্যসম্মত ল্যাট্রিন বসানোর ব্যবস্থা আমরা করাতে পেরেছি এবং বিভিন্ন ডর পানি জীবন প্রকল্পের মাধ্যমে আমরা দেনদারবার করে কিভাবে পিটিশন করব, কিভাবে অধিবেশন করব, কারা পানি স্যানিটেশন নিয়ে কাজ করে তাদের সাথে যোগাযোগ মাধ্যম আমাদের ডর পানি জীবন প্রকল্প সার্বিক কাজে সহযোগিতা করেছি। মা সংসদ এই পুরস্কারটি পেয়ে আমরা অনেক অনেক খুশি, যাতে মা সংসদের মায়েদের অধিকার প্রতিষ্ঠিত হয়েছে, মায়েদের মর্যাদা বাড়ছে এবং আমাদের এই কার্যক্রমটি এলাকা এবং সারা বিশ্বে জানি ছড়িয়ে যায় এবং আমরা যে মায়েরা দরিদ্র হতদরিদ্র পরিবার নিয়ে পানি স্যানিটেশনের সেবা নিয়ে কাজ করছি, এরকম জানি অন্যান্য এলাকায় যে হতদরিদ্র বা পিছিয়ে পড়া জনগোষ্ঠী আছে তাদের নিয়ে যেন আমরা আগামীতে পানি স্যানিটেশন ও সেবার মান উন্নয়ন করতে পারি। এবং আমরা এই পুরস্কার পেয়ে এত খুশি যে আমরা ছোটোখাটো পরিবার এবং নিম্ন স্তরের লোক আমরা যে এইখানে পর্যন্ত যাইতে পারবো, এত দূর পর্যায়ে আমাদের এই পুরস্কার আসবে মা সংসদের মাধ্যমে, আমরা তা কখনো কোনোদিনও কল্পনা করিনি। তাই আমাদের মা সংসদ অনেক অনেক খুশি। আমরা আমাদের মা সংসদকে আপনারা দোয়া করবেন।
She described it very clearly that how they get fully operational by the help of Pani Jivan project. Let me unpack the challenges. At the beginning of their formation, they face challenges like lack of capacity, knowledge, and advocacy techniques. At that stage, Pani Jivan project supported them to build their capacity in acquiring that advocacy knowledge and creating the links with local government, and also they help them how to coordinate and communicate and who worked for which department or who is responsible for what. They create all the links possible and smooth their path. But as now this organization is a organized platform, but now they are facing even more critical challenges is aspect of getting access and demonstration is all the regions. Let me explain. This platform that you showed in the Zamboard that one of the success was integrated budget, but this is not same for all the region they are working for. And in addition, they only focuses on the wash component. If I can recall the video, they want their activities expanded. So they need to create the diverse link by getting involved themselves with other line departments that are working for WASH, health and sanitation. And also they work only the sub-district level. They need to create the vertical links as well. And as they are representing the vulnerable community, it's obvious they don't have same capacity and it's a voluntary organization. So you cannot expect an enforce them by their same interest and commitment for all. Last but not the least, I want to highlight one of the key challenges that this kind of concept still dependent on the external support. And what if Pani Jivan project ends? Will not this Mother Parliament function anymore? No, they will. So it is high time to explore how this kind of platform can become an individual identity rather than depending on some international funding or NGOs on any project support. If I, despite having all these challenges, the speaker was Mother Parliament was very clear that they want their action to be replicated and expanded in other regions in and beyond Bangladesh. Let's check what a professional thinks about this.
I think there is a lot of potentiality and opportunity to replicate this platform because it has already a great success story and the experience they have gained. And we have seen that this United Body as a platform actually brought a lot of success in relation to the water sanitation hygiene. So these similar type of issues can be replicated by themselves in other sub-districts as well as the other programs like Paniya Jeevan. So it is, in one side there is an opportunity, at the same time this has given a ample possibility of women empowerment, those who cannot talk on behalf of their community or the subject. And definitely there is also opportunity to share the issue of the climate justice as well as the education and also the budget allocation and the expenditure, because women does not have any that much of opportunity to talk in decision making process. So this platform has given a lot of decision making opportunity by duty bearers and the right holders.
Can't agree more with Mr. Hassan that this platform has the potential and it gives lot of opportunities for vulnerable women to speak up. And for ensuring this sustainability of this kind of platform, it needs to be brought in wider spectrum and mainstream as well. I'm almost my end of my discussion. So another fun time with Mentimeter. Our link is already shared in the chat box. Please go to the link. Or I'm sharing my screen. You can use the passcode. You can go to www.menti.com and use the passcode 99645997. Or you can scan the QR code as well. So my first question is, how do you prioritize the following activities for the Mother Parliament? Mobilizing resources for climate wash, mapping community needs and planning, joint initiatives through mobilizing elected leaders, coalition and networking with wider platform. You can rank them according to your perception. Yes, these all are they all are working, all these activities, but I want to know, yes, thank you. The first one is mapping community needs planning. Exactly where right you are. Oh, it's moving. And second one is mobilizing resources. Yes. For the smooth implementation, yes, we had already discussed the joint initiative and creating the links with vertical links and coalition with wider networks. Yes, thank you everyone, thanks. My next question is, from your experience, what other activities do you suggest for Mother's Parliament in strengthening water governance? It's open-ended, you can use anything, you can answer anything based on the discussion or your perception. What else or any other activities do you suggest for them? More evidence is sharing at different level. Yes, exactly. Advocacy comes with the evidence. Exposure visit, yes. Coalition building with other women-led initiatives and groups. It can be linked with HLP programs, institutional capacity building. Exactly, this is one of the most important ones, the institutional capacity building. Engagement of young girls to grow. Yes, they are the future leaders. So yes, sharing stories to send others to other communities and countries to inspire. Take independent, okay, thank you for all your participation. My last question is, what has been most striking to you from this discussion? Any key messages for all of us to take home? Her powerful voice, yes. Grassroots can succeed, exactly. Women engagement in governance. Women change maker is the way forward for inclusiveness. Amplified grassroots voices. Innovative idea and facilitation is important to accelerate the process. Make them work and talk. Join leadership. Thank you everyone. We are really running out of time, so I need to close it. So now I would like to invite Ms. Nicole Clot, Senior Advisor to Adaptation to Climate Change, Helvetia Swiss Intercooperation, to summarize the session and convey the closing message. Over to you, Nicole.
Nicole, you're muted if you want to unmute yourself.
Yes, thanks, Mumita. You did a great job in explaining what the Mothers' Parliament is in Bangladesh, which is a real success story. I think it's striking to see how the Mothers' Parliament is a good example of reflecting how local voices can be effective and how an impact they actually can achieve on the ground, and the opportunity it offers to women who can really bring up their voice. It is also an effective means to contribute to climate justice on the ground. It's not just climate justice at the international level, but we also have injustice on the ground. And I think the Mothers' Parliament is an effective means to contribute to this climate justice. So thank you all for listening, and hope you have an impressive learning journey today with Bangladesh. Back to you.
Thank you, Nicole. Thank you, everyone, for your patience. Over to Ellen.
Great. Thank you so much. That was a great opportunity to learn about Mothers' Parliament and to have some fun. We're going to turn it over to IRC now for their game. Ariane, over to you.
Thank you very much and welcome. It is Friday afternoon and I guarantee you will wake up with this one. Okay. Basically, we're going to share the journey we've been having with Watershed, which has been a program that has run for 5 years in 5 countries with 337 different initiatives being carried on advocacy. Laws have been changed, policies have been made, and we've had many publications. But what it comes to is basically raising your voice. So sit back and see and listen how that looks like. For 2 minutes, wake up.
Hello there.
Hello. Hello.
Hi there.
Hey, how are you?
Listen up. Do I have your attention?
Water is life.
Water is important. Water is everything.
Water is water, and people need access to water.
If people have access to water, access to health, it's at the bare minimum of dignity.
Water is a human right.
And so we have to talk about water.
I know that without it, we can do nothing, and without it, we can go nowhere. So I need my voice be heard.
And you can do this.
I know you can. Get involved, because water and sanitation, it concerns all of us.
It's a united issue.
I believe these are all part of the trials, right? It's time we take up water advocacy seriously.
This is the message for you. Water is a human right.
And you have a say in it.
Just like anyone else.
You don't need to be a superstar.
We can't accept whatever comes.
Change will only happen
when you and I speak up.
It doesn't happen overnight. It is a journey.
Have that strength and courage to stand and voice out.
This can be achieved. Your voice can be heard.
raise your voice for water.
Speak your mind.
Raise voice for water.
Raise your voice for water.
Okay, so raising your voice for water is one thing and asking people to raise voices. But you also have to do something and give some solutions, not just raise your voice. And we've got four journeys you can choose from. That's find your evidence, be part of it, or follow the money, or secure your water. And we go by popular choice. So I'm going to ask you on your mobile phone, recommend it, or on another browser, please go to menti.com. And we have a different number than our colleagues just now. We have a number 9468992. And I repeat, 9468992. And let's have a see, where are we going to do? Are we going to be hunting for evidence? Are we going to be part of it? Do we want to follow the money? Or are we going to secure our water? Which is the theme that we want to see all together? Let's have a look. Follow the money is leading. Oh gosh, everybody loves a bit of finance, isn't it? Here, I thought we had a water week. Surely the water should go up a little bit. We have data people in the room. Find your evidence is going up. And nobody wants social inclusions. Somebody is going for that one. I'll give it another minute, or small minutes. Let's see. I expected secure your water to be higher. Personally, that's a favorite. It's one of my favorite four. Find your evidence. And I never prepared for it to be equal. So what would I choose then? One more person, please. One more person to decide it. And we will follow the money. It's chosen and it is said. So here we go. Where are we going to follow the money? Well, let's not forget, we started in Stockholm. We're actually all virtually together, bundled together in Stockholm. And where will this community of follow the money take us? Get ready, strap on your seatbelts, and we fly all the way to Ganjam district in India. About 3.5 million inhabitants. And we're going to be looking at the story of one of them. And we're going to follow the story of...
My name is W. Kamala. I'm the president of our story, the 55th story of our president. That's why I'm the president. The president of our years, I'm the president of the president. जो माँ मानू बा गाँव में जो कौन सी रोग हो जो कौन सी समस्त को सेवा देवार भी से मुझे से आशा करमी एक्चुअली आम आगे जो मैंने घर थे एवं किए घर ना प्राय जी लोक अच्छा से मैंने प्रत्येक लोकर जन जन मेम्बरशिप से मैंने तो निजे अलरेडी समस्त आम जो आवश्यकता से गुड़ा कई सारी पंचायत तरफ आम जो ब्लक तरफ आम विडीओ को भी जनाई एवं कलेक्टर भी जनाई जो आम ये जो गुड़ा असुविधा अच्छी से असुविधा जाक केमी तुम पूर्ण करते अलरेडी भी कम भी आरंभ होता आर्ण होनी ताप प्रोजेक्ट आसी प्रोजेक्ट आईर गोटे कथा कौन आम महिला मानक डाकुं ये प्रोजेक्ट आसगुड़ा महिला मानक दि जाए कि महिला मैंने भी से कम करें किंतु लोक कहते जो झील पे कौन जी कमी बुले कम करेंगे जो झील पिला जो घरे बस थे आज से बाहर को आसी कम कर घर एति कम जाक कलापर भी बाहर कम करम जाक कहीं करें निश्चय कम करेंगे आपन जब पुह पा झील पा भरोसा देवे निश्चय कम कर देश भी आगे जी
Now the game we're going to be playing is I'm going to put you a couple of questions. I'm going to be asking you collectively to take the correct answer. And if we do the correct answers, we will have success. If not, see where we end up. So taking the situation and the follow the money theme, I'm asking you a question on the Mentimeter. Is there money at the Gram Panchayat level for a borehole in Kamala's community? Gram Panchayat level is the local governments. Do they have money to provide a borehole for Kamala? We have heard she's very outspoken. She's able to raise her voice. But is there any funds available? Do let us know. Some people say yes. Some people say no. We have a lot of optimists in the virtual room. I can see nobody is going for no. No, are we going to go for it? Well, it's clear we're going for the yes. And indeed, that was the correct answer. We found, surprisingly, there is enough money around in different funds in different ways, and by making the funds, the books public and finding the ways how to have access to it, we found that there is funds. But is the allocated money being utilized? Another question for you on the Mentimeter. Do you think it is being utilized? The funds that are there, are they being utilized? So have a look. Now we've got some quick people answering. There are lots of people saying no. Some people saying yes. And we must have a lot of wise people in the room, because indeed it is no. When we go to no. So I'm going to ask you, if you were in her place, in Kamala's place, what would be done? What could we think of to improve funds utilization? And again, in the Mentimeter, please put up some words and let's see if you find the words that we've been using. I can hear monitoring. Anything further? Will we be able to continue? Transparency. Anybody going for that? I love let the voice be heard, of course. Campaigning, budget tracking, involve communities. We know a lot of things that can be done. We've been very fortunate to use different ways within the Watershed program. Do ask your questions also as we go along in the chat, but accountability and making sure that budgeting is available and inclusive has been one of the main things that we've been looking at. And in the case of Kamala and in Ganjam district, we've been doing things like institutional mapping. We've been able to identify various sources of funds, and we've been using needs assessment. So basically, where are the people that are unserved? Who actually needs, who's the most vulnerable and should be getting allocated funds? And like you saw from the video from Kamala, we've had women participating to take decisions. So the question, of course, of this, do you think the funds were eventually successful? Did we have enough funds found? Were we successful? Yes or no? Let's see if the same optimists are still in the room there. We've got lots of people saying yes. Some people saying no. And you know, we actually have success on getting construction. We do have some success to get maintenance going. But the main challenge is that following funding streams is a continuous process. It's not a one-off to just secure a single fund to be able to get it. We have to keep working to make sure that there's accountability, to make sure that our budgets are allocated correctly and everyone is covered. But I must say to us all, we have succeeded successfully to go through the journey. And as a reward, let's listen to some of the voices.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hey, you.
What's going on?
Hey, how are you?
Hey, you. Listen up. Can you hear me?
Water is life.
Water is everything. And without water, we can do nothing.
When you talk about water, you talk about health. You talk about food security.
Something that if not taken care of today, will not have it tomorrow.
Water is a human right.
In our country, in Bangladesh, we did not have the separate allocation for water, sanitation and hygiene.
You have to know the budget process. For what you want to be included in the budget,
where is the money coming from and where it is going?
Because it goes to different departments where you have, again, to work silos.
So open budgeting process It was really wonderful, which helped to bring the community people in one place.
Having that knowledge about the budget process, being a budget champion, makes me feel so good.
CSOs started demanding the transparency of budgets, and they asked to make that budget flow online.
So it makes me feel a strong person, because information is power, knowledge is power.
The impact of having open budgets or this discussion was really high.
Now the women are raising their voice.
The Abigail that was there those days is not the Abigail that is now, that is here today, because she's empowered.
I see people really changing their life and getting good feedback. I feel good about it.
It was not meant for me alone, but it was meant for my big community. Bless.
What I will advise you is really to get involved, because water and sanitation, it concerns all of us.
For you to be a champion, and especially on issues to do with water, number one, you don't need to be a coward.
This is my message to the CSOs, that they should work all together.
Not unless we work together, we will go nowhere. But when we join forces, we will work far.
So let's have a cup of tea or coffee.
Raise voice for water.
Speak your mind.
Raise your voice for water.
Raise your voice for water.
So, there are many other voices available on the website as well. Please do go ahead, head over to there. We've got more resources about Follow the Money there as well. It will be put in the chat. And basically what it is getting together, being able to speak up and be able to organize the community. So do help us, enjoy the videos, read the stories. And I'm really, really going to regret this, but as an interaction, I'm going to ask all of you to do one thing, and I shouldn't be doing this. Let's do it. Everybody to unmute and say, raise your voice for water. Let's see how many we get. On the
raise
count.
Your voice for water.
Raise your voice for water. Water.
Voice for water.
Raise your voice.
Raise your voice for water.
Raise your voice for water.
For water.
Fantastic. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
Afterwards. And over to the next game. Thank you all. There are some, if you have questions, Ranjan, Shiny, and Roy are also there to answer questions in the chat. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much, Arian. That was great. And nice to see awesome videos and all the inspiration that happened with that example. So I'm now going to turn it over to Colleen and to Fez from Conservation South Africa for our last game. So over to you. Please continue to type any content questions in the chat. We've got people monitoring that.
Sorry, are you guys seeing my participant notes?
Yes. So I think you want to unshare and share. Yeah.
Yeah, just one. Sorry for the technological challenges here. And thank you, Arian, for getting us all charged up and ready to go. So yeah. Many people in this call who know how to raise their voices for water. And we're going to share another example from South Africa in just a moment, as soon as I can get things started. Okay, here we go. So, hi everybody, welcome. We're gonna take another virtual airplane that has none of the legroom issues and all of the enjoyment. I'm gonna pass it on to Fez, who's gonna walk us through an example of connecting communities and raising voices for water in South Africa. So Fez, take it away.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Colleen. And as Colleen has mentioned, we're going to now zone out and look at the Umzimvubu case study, which is located in South Africa by Conservation South Africa through Conservation International. Now, zone out just for 1 minute or maybe 1 second. Zone out of your current space and just imagine yourself in a very rural village in South Africa where this country is considered a water scarce country, where most of the villages are without water for long periods of time. The case study that we're going to look at is specifically looking at a village in an area called Matatiel in the Eastern Cape province of KwaZulu-Natal. And we're looking at Mvenyane. Mvenyane is a very mountainous area in the Eastern Cape. In fact, it is situated within a strategic water source area in South Africa. And the villages here have access to clean natural water sources. This area has a range of fresh water sources, and these range from either springs, rivers, and streams. But even though there's quite a lot of these fresh water sources around in the villages, there is still there are still issues when it comes to access to the, or rather, getting safe and clean potable water in homes or within the community as a whole. And this has led to the inability to access water for communities has increased because there is climate change. There's now the prevalence of more waterborne diseases. And we don't also have an issue of the presence of alien invasive plants. What happened is in about 2015, Conservation South Africa was already working in this village, looking mainly at rangeland management. And then with the need to secure water for more households in the area, the program then extended to protect springs within the village. And this was done under the Wash in Watersheds program through Conservation International. And the start of this required an extensive stakeholder process. Now, our ultimate goal, basically, with the work that we are doing is to ensure sustainable stewardship of freshwater ecosystems. And these include, this also includes the lands that impact on them. So local people must be engaged and empowered so that they're able to actually manage these ecosystems. There needs to be motivation so that they are land and water stewards, and they're only able to do this when they actually are able to understand how these ecosystems are very important for their health, for the health of their rangelands, but also sustaining livelihoods as a whole. We've then used an advocacy tool to help communities to adapt to this wash and watershed program so that they're able to actually advocate to traditional authorities, municipal government, and other relevant stakeholders in the process of planning, also proposals for funding structures. And this approach ensures that all these components of the wash and watersheds approach is accomplished or managed together. And one of the core aims is to also ensure that youth are involved in the entire discussion for advocating for change. And speaking of youth being involved in the process to advocate for change, you will see that in this picture that's in front of you, this is a picture that you are seeing of the youth who are being trained in one of the many training sessions that we had planned, that we actually initiated in the villages. The trainings seek to build a foundation so that the youth can effectively use their voices towards improving water governance and other water-related issues. The training made sure that it increased the understanding of hydro-related learning for the communities. It empowered our stakeholders and communities with the capacity to identify their freshwater resources, but also to understand their usage and importance as well. It has also sort of enabled our community to be able to identify and increase fresh water conservation efforts in their communities. But also, it's also increased as a whole, the way in which communities go ahead with integrated land rangeland management, because they are now able to actually understand critical systems that actually support environmental systems. This has also been an opportunity to involve more women and youth in the discussions and engagements. And then the approach itself sought to be a bottom-up understanding for best practices for engagement and for securing the right type of infrastructure required for fresh for water security. There are many themes in which they were provided for training. And yes.
Are we ready to play, Fez? So now I'm going to invite you to links in either the Zoom chat or the Passable chat. Fez and I had a little fun with the idea of advocacy is about putting multiple pieces together. So she created a virtual puzzle from the different pieces, and we're going to ask you to click on the link and to assemble this puzzle of the picture that you see in front of you of community capacity building. You know you've successfully connected two pieces together because there'll be like a little flash or pop sound. And after you've successfully completed your jigsaw puzzle, let Fez know that you've won. Send her a emotion from the reactions in Zoom. So either like the little party icon, a thumbs up, a smile. It's a race. We want to see who comes in first. And Fez, you should be able to see the reactions once people have successfully completed their puzzle.
No reactions as yet. I think
everybody's working very hard at putting the pieces together.
And it's also tricky if you get your pieces lost behind other ones. Oh, I'm sorry for those who are having technical challenges. If you try refreshing, you might be able to link it. Otherwise, it may be related to permissions of your computer. We ran into that with one or two colleagues when pilot testing, but hopefully most people can access. And we can also provide links to these puzzles in the chat afterwards. So if you want to go back and refresh the story that you've read today. Are you getting some
reactions? No reactions yet, unless I've missed someone.
Well, maybe this
one reaction. We do.
Woo!
Yes, you have. My apologies. I don't think I had the right view to check anyone.
Fantastic, Fez. Well, it looks like we've got this part of community capacity built put together, but what does this link up with next? Can you tell us about part two?
Yes, sure, I can. I can see that most of you are still trying to finish off the puzzle, but you'll still have plenty of time to put it together. And we'll now move on to the second part of the process. So the second part of the process now looks at the part where people get together. And we're now looking at the meetings that occur within the communities. And in front of you, you're actually seeing a meeting in collaboration between the community, municipal representatives, Conservation South Africa, and other interested parties. What happened here is that the municipal councillor has the community councillor has initiated a discussion with the municipality and Conservation South Africa to plan for a project. And now the consensus was to communicate and involve the youth in the entire process. And these are the youth from the Vinyane village. And these youth are the very same youth who were provided with a capacity building opportunity on freshwater conservation. The councillor requested Conservation South Africa to facilitate the discussion with the municipality so that water can be channeled from a nearby spring and the water would be captured and connected to municipal infrastructure to meet the need for water in the community. It was then agreed that the taps will be installed by the Alfred Zor District Municipality, which is the district municipality in the area, and the community themselves would work together to build and fund this project. Conservation South Africa here plays a role as the facilitator and where required, provide technical guidance. So, again, to help us put the puzzle pieces together, my colleague Colleen is going to lead you through this one.
Okay, I'm posting another link in both of the chats. Okay, so thanks, Fez. We're looking to see if maybe those who got good practice on the first one can be even snappier in the second one. And for highlighting that a really important part of the advocacy puzzle is just what we see now, bringing together local voices with decision makers, facilitating the conversation and ensuring that things are heard, actions are planned, and next steps can be taken. But funny enough, this decision moment when you gathered the youth and other community members with the district municipality isn't the end of the advocacy journey. I'm curious to see what's to come next. Do we have any fast puzzlers, Fez?
Not yet.
Not yet.
I hope I'm a fair judge to this. But I keep flipping through everybody's name to make sure I'm not missing the winner this time round. Colleagues, you're going to have to please help me with an eye to see for that reaction.
You can also celebrate your victory in the chat in either Pathable to capture it forever so it'll be saved at this session or within the Zoom chat. And I can also let you know, Fez, if I see any early indicators. It does take a minute, but that's not unlike the advocacy process. No, you have to try multiple pieces. The two you thought went together, actually you have to try again and it connects with something else. I can imagine there were times along the story when you thought you knew exactly what needed to happen, but lo and behold, it connected to a different piece before the bigger picture could be found. I see a done, Fez, in the chat. We have one early.
I'm not sure if that's from the previous game.
Nope, it came after the link was shared. So we have a up. And I see another
there
puzzle.
We go.
We have at least two. All right.
There
well,
we
while
go.
People are
Ashish.
Finishing up, three. And M. Manjula Islam, congrats to you as well. Well, we have three successful up and Raisa and Veravan, their youth. Wonderful. Okay, Fez, this isn't the
Thank
end of
you.
Our advocacy journey. So tell me what comes next.
What comes next now is action. So we have gone through capacity building, we have come together, we've had discussions, we have negotiated, we've raised our voices as the youth, as the woman, as the community, as the municipality, as CFA. And now it's time to put the capacity building, the discussions and agreements into action. And we then move on to implementation. So now what you're seeing in front of you in this picture is a group of the very same youth that you saw in the training process, being involved in the community meetings. Now, in this picture, you're seeing the group digging trenches to install underground water piping, to transport the water from that local spring to the community tap. Now, this step is very important because not only did it respond to local needs for water, but it also showed that community members actually know how to use their voices and find solutions to work together with the Alfred Zor District Municipality. And together, they were able to plan ahead and try to resolve some of the existing water security issues in the village. And how they plan to do that is they wrote down agreements. There were certain agreements that were agreed on who would be responsible for what role, and some of the overall activities that were planned was the actual digging of the trenches, the installation of the piping. It was the building of new taps. And for the existing taps, it was to fix all the leaking taps and then water purification process. These planned activities would still involve the community, the Alfred Zor District Municipality and Conservation South Africa as well, just to facilitate the process. Now, this is the premise of the wash in watersheds approach, that through the integration of freshwater conservation and wash activities, communities can engage and be empowered as land and water stewards in order for them to protect their health and the health of their ecosystems so that they are able to sustain themselves, right? So through this heightened awareness, there will be conservation and human health and well-being benefits that will contribute to building the resilience of these communities so that there is lesser impact from climate change. Now, we put the puzzle pieces together again.
Yep, I've dropped the links in, Fez, and you know, I really want to draw attention to two things that you highlighted in this step, which is one, until you see promises mm-hmm. made from advocacy efforts into action, we can't consider the work done. It's when mm-hmm. we see promises being delivered on in which we really get the benefits of advocacy, because action is taken. And not only that, like you said, the voices mm. of those who spoke up were heard, and it underlines that, you know, change can happen and you can be a big part of that change. We've got 2 minutes left for our puzzlers to finish up. But I also wanted to really highlight what's so powerful about this example that you've shared, Fizz, is that in an area where service delivery is poor and there's backlogs and challenges, an environmental organization working on rangelands and restoring grasses and removing thirsty alien trees deeply encountered wash and found some of the reasons why there were challenges in these rural villages. Mm-hmm. And these advocacy efforts have really helped communities not only express their frustrations with not having access to water services or sanitation services, but also find ways in which they can partner with the government and find mm-hmm. solutions as opposed to, you know, just issuing formal complaints, that it found a different dimension that previously wasn't working. Have you seen any successful puzzlers come along?
Not yet.
We are almost at time.
Not yet. I suspect everybody's working quite hard to put our
congratulations to Risa. She has just dropped it down in the chat. She's our part three success story.
Thank you, Risa. And well done.
We're so glad you like the puzzles. Fez and I had a lot of fun with really thinking about how a puzzle has been a good analogy for our advocacy process. With that, Fez, as everyone's finishing up, I'm just going to give you a chance to have any final words or to close our session, or even just to say thank you as you do in your beautiful part of South Africa.
No, thanks. Thank you, Colleen. And it's been a pleasure to share some of the stories from a place that I actually call home, because I'm from this area. And it has been an amazing process to see not just people personally being empowered, but actually seeing physical changes that can happen who changed their livelihoods. And from the Eastern Cape, Imadatiela, Inkosi kakhulu.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Fez. And I think I've seen another successful puzzler. So as you're finishing it up, we will pass it back to Ellen, who will help us with the summary and pulling some of these thoughts together. So thanks, great, everybody, for your puzzling talents.
Thank you, Colleen. Thanks, Fez. This was great. Great to see all of the games, to see all of the interaction that everyone's had. We hope that you had fun playing all of the games. Now I want to take you back. I'm going to bring back the presentation. And hopefully everyone can see my screen. Can everyone see my screen? Colleen?
We can.
You yes. can. Great. Yes. Just double checking. Okay, great. Excellent. So, and hopefully what you're seeing on the screen is the questions to think about. I want to come back to these questions. So how did the case study integrate community voices with water resource protection into the governance? What specific changes did you see in policies, practices, or planning through water governance through the social inclusion of voices? And multi-stakeholder partnerships, where did you see those? What role did they play? So I'd love for you to answer these questions in the chat, not in the Zoom chat, but in the pathable chat, and just keep an eye out for those things. And I'm gonna try to go here to see, if I can see the pathable chat at the same time.
I can see it, Ellen, and I can help raise that as well as if people are confused and post in the Zoom chat, I can make sure that moves over into the pathable.
Great, keep an eye out for those things. But basically, you know, I think all three examples and three games that we saw provided these really great examples about how empowering voices creates active participation in decision-making, empowering women's voices, particularly women or communities or groups that are most marginalized, and making sure that their voices are being heard. There's an opportunity to ensure through advocacy that the promises that are being made by government or by decision makers are leading to action. There was lots of examples of capacity building, which was really great. And so making sure that after the capacity was built, that people could really engage and speak for themselves. And then there was a lot around partnership and coalition building. So I'm gonna go back again to these key messages that I showed you in the beginning of the presentation. So local voices can be very effective for influencing change in policies, practices, or planning for water governance. Climate justice on the ground is an important means for successful water governance at local levels all the way up to the national level. And the management of wash and freshwater ecosystems must be connected in plans for holistic management of water resources. So the last thing I want to, as you continue to put your comments into the pathable chat about what you learned during these three games and during these three really great examples, I want to talk about how we can apply this back. And I'm going to give you some examples of how you could apply it, but I'd also like for you to type into the chat how you might use this information. What sparked something really exciting that you think you might want to apply in your work? So one of the things around applying advocacy is making sure that you understand the change that you want to see, and then who has the power to make that change. We heard really great examples of the different actors who were the decision makers in the process and how everyone came together with very clear goals and objectives of what they wanted to achieve, and then turned that through their actions and their partnership into making those changes. So whether that's changes in finance and budget, whether that's changes within the community around policies, or just ensuring that voices are being heard and actively participating in the discussions that are happening already with government officials and those decision-making processes. There's a need and an opportunity to plan for advocacy. So creating a strategy. What you didn't see in all of these examples was all of the tools that were used to support. You saw a little bit of that in the process in each example, but there were lots of tools that were used behind the scenes to plan for what people wanted to achieve. So things like power mapping, identifying the obstacles and opportunities, goal and objective setting, larger political economy analysis, understanding who holds the power within the community to make the change that you'd like to see. And then one of the things that was really interesting that we saw across all of them is this idea of partnership and expanding on partnership. When you partner, you increase the number of organizations potentially or the number of people who are actively working on the issue that you identified. It demonstrates that there is the support for the issue across multiple audiences. It provides an opportunity to improve the ability to reach, persuade a wider set of decision makers when you partner with others. There was some suggestions that were about partnership as a means to build coalitions. Partnerships also mitigate the influence of the opposition. So if there's anyone standing in your way, you can work together to try to get past that. And it brings additional expertise and the skills and the resources to the table, as well as fill any organizational gaps that you might have related to advocacy or other experiences. It creates that diversity of experience and diversity of voices to all speak with one voice. So on that note, we are at the end of our presentation, and we just wanted to say thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it. I want to turn back over to any of our coordination colleagues for any last messages. So Colleen, over to you.
Just one question that came in, Ellen, about power mapping tools. Do you have any suggested ones? And I did post in the chat the ABCG advocacy methodology, but if you want to speak to which specific two tools are in there or others.
Yes, that's great. Thank you so much, Colleen. There are a variety of tools that are out there. There is a course that, thank you, Ariane, for putting that in the chat. There is an online course under the Watch Systems Academy. There's a variety of different tools that exist to do power mapping. And so we can share some of those in the chat, but a lot of the tools and examples that were already used are great ways to identify who holds the power within your community. And understanding that process and then trying to target those folks. So we can provide some of those in the chat. Anyone else have any last minute or final remarks from any of our speakers or any of our game hosts before we finish off today? Okay. Great. Well, thank you again to everyone who participated, sticking through all of the games. We hope you had a wonderful time in these interactive sessions. We'll continue to share links to videos and other content in the Pathable chat. And I'm going to stop sharing my screen here. And we'll just say goodbye at this point. We are happy that you took the time to join us today. And on behalf of all of the coordinating organizations, we'd just like to thank you for your time. And we hope you will use the information that you learned today to raise your voice and to incorporate advocacy and influencing into your water governance, into water governance. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Can you close us with one more? Raise your voice for water.
Raise your voice for water. On the count of three. One, two, three. Raise your voice for water.
Raise your voice for water.
Raise your voice for water. Keep raising it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.